Johnstown, 1936 to the present, is the third in a multi-part series produced by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project in cooperation with WJAC-TV.
March 17, 1936. Johnstown, Pennsylvania suffered severe flooding. By the next day, the water had receded and the cleanup had begun when the word spread that the Quemahoning Dam had burst. Everyone knew the story of May 31, 1889, when Lake Conemaugh burst and rolled down into the Conemaugh River Valley to destroy Johnstown. Panic-stricken, people ran for the hills. Johnstown reporter William H. Rogers remembers the event. It was hours before the rumor was proven false. Hundreds were soaked in the cold, drizzling rain as they waited for the rushing wall of water to wipe out the city. Extra papers all over the country said the city was annihilated. Radio stations over the nation took up the cry, "History repeats, Johnstown wiped out." Several hours later, the rumors were dispelled, and those who could returned to their homes in the valley to continue mopping up and clearing away the mud. This St. Patrick's Day flood was but one of many that had occurred throughout Pennsylvania. In the days that followed, the city was cleaned up and a successful drive began for federal money to dredge the rivers and restructure the riverbanks for a flood-free Johnstown. These were the 1930s, and times were hard. Of the 66,993 people who lived in Johnstown, most worked in the Bethlehem steel plants there. In 1937, Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president of the United States. It was an era of public works programs designed to move the country out of economic depression. The Democratic leadership at the state and local levels, which accompanied the Roosevelt administration, was sympathetic to the laboring man. Now, the American Federation of Labor and the Congress of Industrial Organizations, the country's largest national unions, could begin the successful organization of the country's laborers. In the spring of 1937, the U.S. Steel Company, the largest steel producer in the world, recognized the CIO as the bargaining agent for its workers. The CIO's organizing branch, the Steelworkers Organizing Committee, had been working in Johnstown with marginal success since the summer of 1936. Bethlehem Steel instituted an employees' representative plan with the hope of warding off union activities in their Johnstown plants. But Bethlehem was one of the companies targeted for union activity that year. Besides, many of the workers there complained that they could not choose their representation and that the company's methods of payment were arbitrary and unfair. An undetermined number of Bethlehem's workers secretly carried union cards. And when the strike began with the 11 o'clock shift on June the 11th, 1937, about one-third of the workforce refused to cross the picket lines.
Oh, workers, can you stand it? Tell me how you can. Will you be a lousy scab or will you be a man? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Tell me which side are you on? Which side are you on?
By Thursday of the first week, a citizens' committee of the community business people met and publicized their opposition to the strike. By the first day of the next week, the state police were called to assist. By Friday of that week, the governor of Pennsylvania sent in the National Guard. The governor also ordered Bethlehem Steel to close the plant and union leader John L. Lewis to cancel a scheduled rally. In another week, some of Johnstown's clergy, the Citizens Committee, and groups of workers who wished to return to work petitioned the governor to reopen the mills. The governor rescinded his order and the plant reopened, with most of the men returning to work. The cause of unionization seemed to be lost again. But the strike activity called attention to the relationship of the steel company to the community, and a federal hearing was conducted to investigate the events at the Bethlehem plant in Johnstown during the 1937 strike. At the hearing, it was discovered that during the period of the strike and immediately following, Bethlehem had buried $41,750 in the company's books under various manufacturing costs. When the truth was known, some of the money was shown to have financed the Citizens Committee. $31,000 of it had gone directly to the mayor. 2 years later, the National Labor Relations Board ruled that the Bethlehem Employees Representation Plan was company-dominated and ordered it be disbanded. The Labor Relations Board forced Bethlehem to allow their workers to vote for their own representation. As the community awaited the election date, both the union and its opposition exerted pressure on the laborers. Headlines from the Daily Democrat suggest the line of defense many of the city's business and professional people likely took. Detroit, John L. Lewis and the CIO, a great city's road to ruins. Inquirer survey shows CIO and depression came hand in hand. Akron, John L. Lewis and the CIO, one-third of residents on relief as heads of rubber industries move factories to other cities. But when the election was finally held, the Bethlehem workers at Johnstown voted to join the CIO.
Oh, we are the men of the Steelworkers Union, from blast furnace, open hearth, foundry, and mill. From ingot mold stripping, from scarfing and chipping, from out where the slag pots are dumped on the fill.
Life was not all hardship for Johnstowners in the 1930s. At least some of the city's leaders began to look for the resources to promote the city as a tourist stop. An article in the Daily Democrat reported that a survey of the guest book at the Incline showed a large number of visitors from other states or even other countries. The reason for the sudden interest? The publicity the Hillside Railway received for transporting city residents to higher ground during the 1936 flood. In May, the paper reported a group of travel promoters on a tour sponsored by the Pennsylvania Publicity Commission came to Johnstown to ride the incline and visit the plot of the unknown flood victims at Grandview Cemetery. These were the times of neighborhood theaters, and the Lyric was opened on the 500 block of Franklin Street. Parking meters were installed in the city downtown area, and the new post office built. Dial telephones were installed. Now city residents could make local calls without the assistance of an operator. At the same time, Bethlehem began to improve its Johnstown facility. The axle plant and the blooming mills were modernized, and so the mills were prepared when England and France declared war on Germany. Production soared. When American boys marched off to join the war, American girls marched into the steel mills to be welders, riveters, rollers, or whatever was necessary. When the boys came home, the girls went back to their former jobs. The next decade would be remembered forever as America's glorious years. Everyone worked during the wars. Many people made more money than ever before. Rationing is also part of war, as many plants which normally produce such consumer goods as automobiles then produced war materials. There were a limited number of things to buy and war bonds to be bought, so people saved. When the war was over, American goods couldn't be made fast enough. There were production demands to meet for American consumers and for the war-torn countries in Western Europe. With its 124 industries, the Johnstown economy boomed.
Thank you.
mid-20th century was fun, too, at least for Johnstowners.
Johnstown, Johnstown, Pennsylvania, yeah. Johnstown, Johnstown of the USA. Johnstown, Johnstown, the city with the will. The city that floodwaters couldn't kill. Let's play the Johnstown polka. For the city with the will. Let's play the Johnstown polka. The city that floodwaters couldn't kill.
A new municipal airport with passenger service was built in Richland. And Johnstown, with its 150 retail and 18 department stores, was the commercial center for two counties. The city had 305 grocery stores, 68 restaurants, and 36 hotels. There were 8 theaters and many social halls, and organizations held dances for teenagers and adults. A person could even take ballroom dancing from the Arthur Murray Dance Studio on Bedford Street. But the boom wouldn't last. As the decade rolled into the 60s, consumers wound down their spending spree and the European countries rebuilt. A forecast for the 20th century given in a speech by Cyrus Elder at Johnstown's 100th anniversary in 1900 returned to haunt the city.
What are the changes which may be looked for during the next 100 years? Will railroads be superseded by some new methods of transportation and the shares become as valueless as turnpike stock? Will steel be replaced by some lighter and stronger and cheaper metal? Will steam and compressed air and electricity give place to some force which creates itself and costs nothing, like solar energy, the ocean tides, or the pressure of the atmosphere? Will there be a different kind of man and a new social and industrial order?
Gas and oil shortages plagued the 70s. And as the century moved into its latter half, new products replaced steel and technologies changed so that fewer men were needed in the mills.
This is the last blast furnace to operate at the plant. It's been in operation since 1957. The reason for the shutdown? Electric furnaces. Two of them have been installed at the plant and are being tested right now. The 185-ton electric furnaces are cold-charged and do not require molten iron. They'll make steel from scrap iron. So, today was the last time molten iron poured from the huge furnace into submarine ladles. For the past several years, this process has been repeated about 8 times a day, producing nearly 2,000 tons of iron every 24 hours. This last cast produced about 200 tons of iron, and this iron will be the last to go through the open hearth furnace, where it will be refined into steel. The open hearth furnace will be tapped for the last time in the next few hours. Phasing out of the blast furnace operation is taking a toll on the plant's workforce. Most of the open hearth workers will be reassigned to the electric furnace operation. However, most of the 300 blast furnace workers will be laid off.
New competition also decreased orders.
These plants, already suffering from depressed markets, could no longer bid on contracts in their respective areas against non-union, domestic, and foreign operations, or against those domestic companies whose unions, in many instances, again, steel worker unions, steel worker locals, and operating at substantially lower labor rates than extended to the integrated producers. Johnstown simply has been unable to penetrate the critical commercial, industrial, and defense markets with its products because of its comparatively high labor cost.
Here in Johnstown, 540 active workers stand to lose their jobs, along with another 250 on layoff.
Does it take concessions by the steel workers to make the car shop competitive?
Yes. It does.
America's industrial cities seemed doomed. To complicate matters in Johnstown, on the evening of July 19th, 1977, a heavy storm hovered over the Conemaugh River Valley and dumped over 11 inches of rain in less than 9 hours. Johnstown Tribune Democrat reporter Larry Hudson undoubtedly expressed the community's feelings.
A flood is better off in the pages of history books. There, it's refined and condensed into a nice, neat little story. A package of words and pictures set tidily on pages of paper and chapters of books that can do you no harm. But there are some things the history books never told us. They never told us about the panic or the heroism for the evil, devastating things that water can do to wood, metal, concrete, automobiles, and people. They never told us about the twisted limbs of the victims and the sudden quickening your heart takes when the rubble falls away and through the mud a body takes form. They never told us that the image of a dead child can penetrate a sleeping mind and shoot you bolt upright in bed. We never learned from the history books about the rubble, the lifted streets and sidewalks turned and tilted into grotesque heaps, how the cars flatten against trees and buildings, and how they swirl like plastic toys, bobbing and turning until they settle atop parking meters, telephone poles, and other cars. And they never told us about the mud. Mud piled higher than your head, mud that's impossible to walk in, mud that's mixed and remixed and trampled and retrampled and swirled again, mud that sticks to your feet, your hands, walls, homes, tires. Mud that can't be swept with a broom but has to be coaxed and cajoled into tiny floods until it slops over the doorstep and out into the muddy street to join a river of mud going God knows where. The history books never told us about the smell. Sewer gas so raw it burns your eyes and throat, and then the musty warm odor of brown water, slopping brown water that just won't go away. The smell of death, the wood smoke, of fires that burned out of control, the rotten food, ice cream, vegetables, wet paper, and wet dogs, mushy carpets, damp plaster, and wallpaper, the smell of yourself. Not a word in the history books about the dogs and cats that wandered around homeless, starving, stealing from the outdoor stoves and grills, challenging survivors for a piece of doubtful meat, about the animals romping into the water, swept into open manholes, animals shot because what else could we do? The book said nothing about what it's like to walk knee-deep in the slime while the dust from the streets choked your throat, clogged your nose. They never told us that boiled water turns dark and tastes much the way we all feel. We've read of death tolls, exact statistics, tidy numbers, faceless facts. We've heard the stories of heroism, but we've never read about the hero shaking hours afterwards, running to the window to vomit 2-3 times an hour. We've had tales of charity, stories of Clara Barton, yarns of the panic in the streets, but they never told us how much it would hurt. The history books didn't say a word about unwashed bodies, the psychological thirst that comes when you know that water is limited, the vacant stares from the eyes all around you, everywhere. And the books contain nothing about the way the sun comes up, pouring incongruity upon devastation, nothing about birds singing as the dead lay heaped, and not a word about how your life is brought to a shattering, traumatic halt, about the fear of the future, a new city, new relationships, rebuilt businesses, and only memories of many you knew and loved. They never told us how we greet a friend along a ruined street, how we just have to touch, a lingering handshake, a pat on the shoulder, some physical reassurance of each other's presence, a small victory in the midst of major loss. They never told us about the lumps in our throats, the knots in our stomachs, the sudden realization that we really did love a city. The history books never told us these things. They just told us it would never happen again.
The city rebuilt again. And as it rebuilt, an economy that had formerly been secondary to the city's industrial base began to emerge on its own. It had only been a few years since Johnstown businessman Frank Pascarella announced the expansion of his company. Mr. Pascarella's company did grow, and in the early 1980s, he had more good news for the community.
Good afternoon. Crown American Corporation has announced the largest one-phase construction project ever in the history of Johnstown. The relocation of the Crown headquarters was made official this morning.
At the same time, others moved toward bringing new industries. The regional office of Metropolitan Life Insurance, for example, and the corporate offices of the Pennsylvania Electric Company. At the same time, the city's three hospitals expanded their services and modernized. And a new National Center for Excellence in Metalworking Technology was established in conjunction with Johnstown's branch campus of the University of Pittsburgh. A group of city leaders pushed for the development of tourism in the area. Former Johnstowner Jack Sheehan and a group of other investors purchased the closed U.S. steel plant to establish the Johnstown Corporation.
Johnstown Corporation isn't wasting any time in getting started. Chief Executive Officer Jack Sheehan predicts the product will be shipped in 6 weeks.
We intend to be a supplier to the entire United States steel industry, and I will not be satisfied until we are shipping product to Japan from this facility.
At nearly the same time, the Bethlehem Steel Corporation made a special commitment to Johnstown.
This means the electric furnace goes online again July 25th. Bethlehem expects it to be operating at near capacity by the beginning of next year. Employment in the division at that time will be about 3,500. The future of the Johnstown plant is a lot more clear today.
And the Bethlehem Steel Corporation decided to sacrifice its Lackawanna for its Johnstown plant.
Excellent news. It's great for the community and it's great for the workforce. The option was, or the alternative was, that we wouldn't have a steelmaking operation in Johnstown. Decision came in favor of Johnstown because of the workforce, because of the new equipment, and indeed, now we have to perform. It means 300 or 400 people from the primary mills and from steelmaking back to work in 1983 who may not have worked in 1983.
It has been only 89 years since the 100th anniversary of the city of Johnstown. The speakers and their large audiences that gathered at the centennial celebration would not have wanted to know the suffering the community would endure over the next 100 years. They had suffered enough and looked hopefully toward a brighter future. As they faced the 20th century, centennial speaker Cyrus Elder dared to predict the future.
Whatever the future may have in store, the mission of Johnstown is not ended.
He and his listeners knew that theirs was a rare heritage.
This mission of usefulness, which Johnstown has performed, is a unique and undisputable title of honor.
Johnstowners today can claim the same proud heritage and more. And despite two more horrible floods and the sacrifices that have and continue to accompany the challenge of change, Johnstowners today must consider Attorney Elder's forecast for the year 2000.
Whatever the celebration of the second centennial of Johnstown may disclose, and much of it is unimaginable to us, there will be no halt in this progress.
Johnstown, 1936 to the present, was produced by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project in cooperation with WJAC-TV.